Jesus stands, renowned from him we swear, the grace of God is the source. He that rules the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is watching from
where. Well, praise the Lord, brothers.
Praise the Lord.
Once again, we're broadcasting live here from Birmingham, Alabama, and this is the 17th day of June in the year of our Lord, 2021. We welcome you to Discussing the Truth broadcast. I am your announcer, Antonio Green. Our host for this broadcast is Pastor James A. Dance, and our co-host, Minister Kelvin Peter. We have Minister Milton Dudley on this panel with us as well. And it is our prayer that God the Father, through Jesus Christ, his Son, by the power of the Holy Spirit, would speak truth to your hearts. Pastor Dance.
Well, praise the Lord, guys.
Praise the Lord.
Thank God for Jesus, man. God, another opportunity, praise God, to offer this year's life in the midst of so much darkness. We know that the light is the Lord.
He is right.
The light of the world.
That's right.
We acknowledge that. I was here right here. So I was here right here.
You know, would like you somebody to have an easier job.
Get a better place. Get a better place. Well,
you know, and sometimes I marvel at guys that have such experience. What do you think about Juneteenth? That's a holiday.
That's a holiday.
You took down George Washington. You took down Abe Lincoln. You took down a lot of holidays.
That's a holiday.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Biden just signed it today. No, don't go too far now. Look, you gotta go work. Look,
is that what they say? But what I think about it, Pastor,
it's
terrible because it's based on a lack of knowledge. Now, we know the fact of the matter, June 19th was when the Union soldiers got to the place to let them know that they were free. January 1st was the day, 2.5 years early, is when the slaves were actually free.
Okay.
So it's all a big mix-up, and what they're trying to do with it is rewrite history.
Basically,
rewrite history. You know, saying that, and that creates the big. Because June 19th, the celebration is aimed at one demographic group.
Okay.
One demographic group. You're the only one that really have any call to celebrate. And even though it's something that the country did, you know, it's targeted at one group of people.
Right.
You know, but we're all Americans, so what's wrong with it?
Well, what really we put so much emphasis on race today, and that's what really bothers me. And I think most black people, one of the things he made the statement that we judge people based upon their character, not the color of their skin. That's right, it's not to the character, not the color of skin. Have we gone away from that? I thought King was one of the people that we looked to for.
Well, up until now. See, and they've been labeled, a lot of people have been labeled as useful idiots to facilitate this Marxist agenda.
Okay.
Yeah, they will lift you up and hold you in high esteem until they get what they need out of you. And then they're done with you.
So back to the Marxist thing that Kevin related to, in Marxism. So what we're saying is that they're using it as a divergent
force. Absolutely.
Huh? A Trojan horse.
Yes.
Have we been holding to it, line and sinker. And that's sad, isn't it?
It is.
When there are so many other issues to be dealt with.
Yeah. Legitimate issues.
But that goes back to Khrushchev and all the other leaders in these countries that are racing, all of them said they're going to take America down from the inside.
Absolutely.
Are we playing into the head? The confusion, the hatred, and all that's going on today. And they're not going to have to fire a shot. They're just going to take over, look like it.
Why just eat each other alive?
Well, they ain't gonna take it over. We're gonna give it to them.
That's what we're doing.
That's what we're doing. Where are the Christian people now in this bullshit?
I.e. the problem.
So again, sir?
I.e. the problem. The Christians are too silent, have been for too long, and we better start looking at this as the judgment of God. If we don't stand up, if we don't turn back to God,
especially
on our faith.
Yeah, okay.
This nation is done.
Okay. So that we at a crucial point. Yeah, you think so?
I believe so. No.
So what you're saying is Jesus is the answer.
Absolutely.
Well, why can't you, we're spending billions of dollars every day to try to rectify the problem that we have. Why don't nobody said thank God the Lord? Let's turn it to prayer. Let's go back to why these intelligent people,
if you do that, if you accept the fact that Jesus is the answer, you gotta act right.
Okay.
You gotta act
right. It works totally against the system. Okay. First of all, I gotta act right. I gotta treat people right. I have to act right.
If you accept that premise, right, Christ is the answer.
Secondly, Jesus being the answer is free, so nobody ain't gonna make no money. Think about it.
Black Lives Matter won't have no kind of organization at all.
Right. So,
won't have no rights or nothing.
Right.
So that'll help
you. Well, as you can see, they implode because the people inside who've been on the ground, the foot soldiers, they want to know what happened to the money. They know they were given, donated, plenty of money.
Right.
So they ride as ants. I don't know why. I know what money.
I know what money is. So Kevin, what you said is if the world break down and accept Christ as a solution to all of our problems, and the problem is a heart problem, you know, and if we accept Him, then that'll change the whole course of history, the way we operate each and every day. And so it won't be a lot of under the table dealing going on, huh?
No, all that will go away. But we would have the utopia that these people are trying to create.
Okay. These quality,
yeah, right. They say what they're trying to create.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We would actually have a much better place, the place that they're selling us.
So it's a heart problem, really? It's
definitely a heart problem.
You can't legislate morality and heart.
So it really shows you that that's not their agenda anyway.
It's not that
because in a land that's riddled with crime and all the other issues that we're dealing with, and their cry is less law enforcement. You gotta know that that's not their agenda to reduce or get rid of crime.
How do you even say that in the beginning?
You know what I'm saying?
28 people killed in 2013 this past week.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. But well, this one, because the news probably wouldn't even hear it if all the truth in Chicago would begin to voice the fact that we need to turn back to the Lord. Maybe they are doing it. And the news won't cover
it. What's your opinion, sir? Because whether the news covered or not, but you know, God, when you go to God and with earnest heart, you get results. We will see the results.
Okay.
We will see.
So you don't think the leaders in a big city like Chicago are serving the Trump and his line? You don't think they're really lifting the name of the Lord during this crucial time?
You mean the man who's married to another woman? That's who the leaders you're talking about?
Bill Lightfoot.
Yeah. Yeah, who won't accept interviews from white journalists or white interviewers, but she's married to a white woman? Is it not gaslighting? Is it not virtue signaling? No, y'all ain't getting none of that.
I wasn't aware of that.
You were not?
I wasn't aware of that.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, the white.
I was not aware of that.
Air quotes. I know y'all. Yeah, white.
Yep. But she won't speak to white reporters.
No, that, no.
Only interview.
No, they can't interview. They can't have any of her time.
You gotta be black. Okay, well, you know, gentlemen, you know, these are issues that we're facing today, but like I say, I it escapes me. Because now, like I said, the word of God is confirmed in my spirit to know that these people that are so highly educated, they have the big degrees, but yet and still, they can't see that there's a problem within man. Taking the guns away is not gonna solve the problem. Understand what I'm saying?
No.
It all comes back to an issue of the heart.
That's right.
And we know only one person that even has even stepped up to the plate and said, I can remedy that problem, right? Give you a new heart and a new spirit.
Mm.
Only one person has done that. And that's Jesus Christ, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Huh? But yet they rejected him.
Okay. Rejected.
But that Kevin said the whole thing.
Yeah.
That would make too many changes. And
people
would be responsible.
Out of business. The race baiters and all that would be out of business.
Just couldn't make the money making and all that. Okay.
No way.
Okay. Okay. Well, we did with that race theory, you know, and I think all these things kind of, you know, lump together.
They do sin. They in the sin basket.
They in the sin basket. All of them in the basket together, you know. But, you know, I just, you know, keep on telling people. I'm telling the guy at work last night there. I don't know what this morning when I came in. I get ready to leave and come in, and you know, he wants to talk, you know, every now and then he wants to talk about the situation. James, what you think about the Bell Tourism Crisis? What you think about Buckhead over in Atlanta? We can put out from Atlanta, Georgia. Buckhead went out because the crime has gotten so bad.
They said it started
in Buckhead. Have y'all ever been to Buckhead? Huh?
Yeah.
Have you been out?
No. Yeah.
You ever been to Buckhead? Oh, it's like
Well, the first Pride Parade was here. You know that, right?
I know. Yeah, it wasn't big dollars.
That's
but the crime has gotten so bad until Buckhead and the Atlanta mayor, get her name now. She refused to deal with it. You know, so now they're going to court, right? To start their own city, which they are financially able to do it.
Oh, yeah.
like on wood.
Right.
They can do it. But if your bunkhead pull out from Atlanta, all the same money.
Gone.
They put most of the bill, you know, for a lot of the things that go on in Atlanta, you know. And, you know, but all these things going on, and, you know, Christ is the answer to this problem. That's what, that's what I keep on telling people. I told them last night, you know, I said, man, the Lord is the answer. You know, we can sit in and talk about the mandatory context coming up, the prospects of, you know, but until we can, you know, put people in that, not to call it black, you know, I just told him basically like that. I said, if you got a white guy running with an MIT degree, he's got a good track record of you know, being fair and bringing in business, he's got his wealth connected. Around. And then you got a black guy, he ran out the hood, and he don't know ABC, he don't know how to shoot models, you know. And but yet and still, because the population of Birmingham is 80% black,
right.
They gonna vote for the black man, regardless of whether he's able to run this city or not, you know. It's just, but like I say, we have gone a long way from King's philosophy, you know, of, you know, not skin, but, you know, not to color. Okay, Kevin,
hey.
You have a young lady here named Ricky Charlotte. She got a bit of a feel. And talk about Generation Z. Now, y'all, who is the Generation Z again? Now, this is a good article here, viewpoints here. Let's cut into a little bit of what she had to say as she looked at this new segregation here. The new segregation.
Segregation. That's what it is.
Exactly what it is. Critical race theory from a Generation Z perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
You might wonder why you should care about what a college kid has to say just about the
topic. Okay.
I don't blame you, but on the topic of critical race theory, I would argue we're uniquely qualified to be a college Z. I'm an older member of Generation Z. My childhood was not bridged by bootlegged pseudo philosophy. I'm thankful that you can remember a time when Martin Luther King's mission was celebrated and upheld in my school. But I also was thrust into the critical race theory worldview early in my high school career. My sub-generation, those of us around college age today, teetered immediately on the cusp of the explosion of this neo-racist
theory
talked about CRT.
Yeah. Right.
As such, we may be the only ones able to remember a time without it, but also know what it means to be steeped in this perverse worldview. My first recognizable experience of critical race theory came when I was a freshman in high school. In celebration of Martin Luther King Day, we congregated in the auditorium for lectures and activities. I always approached this day with your particular reverence. I was taught its value as a child. It's a day to recognize common humanity and celebrate our country's progress toward justice. But that year, my experience was entirely different. After an introductory speech, the entire student body was told to report to a specific room or building based on their racial identity, systematically segregated students throughout the campus. In doing so, the leaders of the event chose to promote the impression that only those in the same racial category are able to relate to the feelings and experiences of one another. As such, they suggested that conversations about race are better segregated than community-based. Ironically, on Martin Luther King Day.
So, hold on just a minute, Jeff. So how you gonna cut the other? First of all, you're gonna segregate them.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
So you're not able to empathize.
There's no reason, there's no debate, there's no bouncing ideas on, you know, any of that.
Yeah, let's keep all races together. Then those races will talk.
Find a common.
Yeah.
That can't happen like this.
Right.
Okay, go ahead, Gary.
I was only 14 years old at the time. Years old at the time. It would be years before I even heard the term critical race theory. But nonetheless, I knew then and there that I had seen it. Ever since then, I have watched different iterations of this philosophy creep into my education, impacting the broader culture and mindset of my contemporary.
That's it.
Identity politics have exploded on my college campus. The natural byproduct of this misguided field racist education we're sleeping. Generation Z has been divided and told to be one another through the lens of color and difference. And we have done exactly that.
Generation Z are the people born between 1997 and 2015.
Okay, 97.
Okay, 18 years. Yeah, everybody born in there. Right, just before.
Yeah, right. Okay, bring it a little bit more, Kevin.
As a believer in Martin Luther King's authentic mission and cause,
right,
this worries me in a truly visceral way. As a culture, we're willingly turning our backs on the values that promote inclusivity.
Wow.
I worry in particular for the children younger than I, who have never known any
difference.
Can't recall the time before their immutable characteristics were deemed their defining attributes. Well,
that's something, really, just think about that, though.
You're black, you're white, therefore you act and think.
You are this. Just like the inherently racist thing.
And here's the thing about it, Kevin. These kids have grown up and come to school together from little top.
Right.
You know, not like us. We was in secondary school. I was, anyway. I don't know where y'all were. Me and Milton don't know about no big school, you know. And but yet still, even the young generation, they come up with as toddlers together.
Right.
And now you going all of a sudden, you want to
tell them, go right back.
Oh boy, go ahead.
It's just like the Bible teaches us, Pastor.
What's that?
There's nothing new under the sun. It's the same circle.
Okay, you're going around now.
Yeah, it's the same circle.
You know, it'll make you think about, you know, this commercial. I don't know what they've advertised, but on the commercial, they got the boy, the black boy,
walking down the sidewalk.
And, you know, it's just amazing how the kids can get caught up in this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
You know, they can look back and say, hey, you know, you're not living that color.
Yeah.
No.
That's right, bro. And they don't if we believe them alone.
You dig up a dinosaur.
Yeah.
You dig up a dinosaur in the name of progress. So,
how is that? How do you go back to progress, though? How do you go back to progress? Put your car in reverse.
You got to be a Harvard scholar. You ain't no Harvard scholar.
Oh, that's what it is.
That's why you don't understand that, though.
I'm blissfully ignorant.
Yeah. Go ahead, Doc. Get in. Let's give a little bit more of that.
Activist teachers and administrators have hijacked the parental responsibility.
That is.
Parental responsibility of activating children and shaping their senses and selves and their general
worldview.
And while all authorities seem to bow down to this new ideology, it's no wonder impressionable young people are swept up in it.
Right.
Those such true supporters of a critical race theory may be a few in number, they're a powerful minority.
Yes, go.
Through cancel culture and reputation destruction, their threats of intimidation and slander render them able to shut down most all opposition.
And again, the media is so complicit. And the media by itself is so powerful.
Right.
And the media, even though, yes, it's a small percentage of people that just come right out and say, we're free with this CRT thing. But yet it's still because of the media and the billionaires and the sports jockeys, billionaire sports guys, all of them standing behind it. People that may not go along with it, they're going to keep silent.
Right.
Rather than being intimidated or even punished, you know?
That's right.
Read.
But I have hope, too. There has been a tidal wave of awareness around the critical race theory in very recent times.
That's good.
I've been willing to bet that most people, like myself, don't even know the term mere months ago. Nonetheless, it now dominates the national dialogue.
Yes, sir.
We're acutely aware of its denigrating effect on society and the well-being of our future generations, parents, teachers, politicians, and activists alike have joined forces to fight this fragmentation of race. Even whole organizations have sprung up in opposition.
That's right.
This is what fills me with optimism. Despite the severity of the situation, it by it, by hope,
right,
that
right,
more members of my generation, mm-hmm, who are uniquely situated in their perspective,
right,
will come forward to.
Mm-hmm.
We have been a silent majority,
yeah,
and now we're making ourselves heard. If you think about that, that's true.
That's right. Yeah.
Tony and I, we never experienced that, but they're in a sweet spot to where they were like at the very beginning of it,
mm-hmm,
but could see a difference, you know, before it ever happened.
Yeah.
And DJ, he just gonna be, you know, he just,
well, that, and that's what I'm afraid of, that there's gonna, you know, just like the Bible said back in the in Joshua, they arose a generation that knew not the Lord.
Right, right,
this,
right,
this generation that's coming behind us may never have seen a time.
Yeah.
Right, right.
When, you know, when it was in it, we're not far from that.
That's right.
We're not far from that.
That's right. But he tells you, when we have been a silent majority, and now we'll speak it up. And that's my prayer, that people will begin to, you know, to speak up a little bit more concerning, you know, this division here, because it has its tendency. It's all over the world, man. It's,
well,
not just the United States, you know.
It absolutely, Pastor, it's a worldwide thing.
It's worldwide.
And there, we only know, we know that, like the Bible teaches, there's only one race of people.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
there are different demographics of people all over the world. Yeah. But why are they dealing with just these two particular ethnicities? Yeah.
Well, I think America has been a target, you know, for all of these non-Christian countries, you know.
Yeah.
And they have all come together to try to bring America out to these, to reach history, change history, change everything.
Well,
you know,
the idea.
Yeah.
The idea of America goes against, flies in the face,
yeah,
of what they're trying to do. So people have hope when you, America creates a hope. People, it,
yeah,
gives people hope that life can be better.
Yeah. Right,
you know,
right,
that,
right,
that,
right,
you can be free. That
you need that hope. That hope is, right, very important, that people have. You know, they have a belief that things can get better, you know, as far as, you know, their life, their life's livelihood and so forth.
Absolutely.
Like you're saying, so many of this generation has been silent.
Yeah.
That's because they, like I said, they done brainwashed, they done shaped.
Oh, yeah.
To say, you know, just like you can go on a campus nowadays and ask them, how do you feel about transgender?
Yeah.
And they're not going to speak to you, you know, because they're afraid of the backlash.
Yeah,
they're afraid of,
council culture.
Yeah,
council culture.
I mean, all of that. Going to Tony's question about why I've been focusing on black and white.
Yeah.
You know, really, the world is just made up of those people of color and those people that are not of color.
That's right.
So when you split it down the middle, a perfect example of that is the Asian community. They're minorities, but they're going to pick the white folks out.
Yeah.
You know, and it causes division still.
Yeah.
It causes division with that small minority, with the bills that they pass and the protection that they render them that they didn't do African Americans. It causes more division, which is still there.
Yes,
there you go.
Yeah.
Well, that's good, bro. That's good. It's the same thing. It's a long, outgrown agenda that really started years and years and years ago, and they knew they were gonna have to get the minds of the children in order to do it. So, but I was encouraged by this. If you don't mind,
please go ahead.
Playing a short video.
Hold what you got for me on there, Kevin. Okay. Go ahead.
I was encouraged when I heard this young man and his daughter speaking. But let's check.
You can be anything in this world that you want to be, right? Don't daddy teach you that?
Yeah, and it doesn't matter if you're black or white or any color.
Doesn't matter if you're black, white, brown, yellow, right?
Black.
And how we treat people is based on who they are and not what color
nice.
They are.
And if they're nice and smart.
See, this is how children think right here. Critical race theory wants to end that. Not with my children. It's not gonna happen. My baby's gonna know that no matter what she wants to be in life, all she has to do is work hard and she can become that.
Work hard. Even though you don't know anyone, you can make friends.
Yeah, you can make friends, no matter what color they are. So we need to stop CRT, period, point blank. Children do not see skin color, man. They love everybody. They're good people, they love them.
We pray for people that are hurt.
We pray for people who are hurt.
Yes.
We pray for people who are hurt.
Well, that's what Jesus said about coming to them.
sex. Of a child. That's right.
And you know, even in our military, right? Go ahead, Kevin. You I want you to finish that argument. You just got through.
Wasn't that it?
That was it. Okay. Yeah. You know, even in our military, they have brought a lot of division.
Absolutely.
With the CR.
So much skill.
And brother, I'm gonna tell you something. I went in the Air Force in 1965. And that was no discrimination as to what field I could go in if I scored high enough on the test. Because I didn't score high enough to get what I wanted to get it from the test. But I didn't come high enough, you know, caliber here.
But whose fault was that?
That was my fault. Number one, because I didn't do no prep work for it. You know, if I knew that's what I wanted to do, then I should have been preparing, for the testing in that area, you know, but I didn't, you know, just off the cuff, you know. But now some of my other friends that, they went in intelligence, and I mean, they scored so high until they got them secret clearance and all that. Yeah. Intelligence, yeah. Right here. Remember that. But we weren't discriminated at that time. Why?
That's why I can't accept it today, Pastor. Anybody living today, mm-hmm. as atrocious as slavery, Jim Crow, all that stuff was.
It was sinful and it was wrong.
But it is not what's holding you back today.
Sure, not.
Today, and for the last few generations, opportunity has been widely available for anyone who takes advantage.
In 65, it didn't hold us back then. All we had to do was score, meet the requirements.
Yeah. We're not saying, audience, is that there's no such thing as racism or people don't have skin bias differences or whatever. We know that, but that's the hard issue.
Yeah, that's the hard issue. And that's going to be a pocket of people like that everywhere you go.
Period.
But overall, you know, the opportunities are there. They were there for me, you know. But I did go high enough to go to ground power, you know. That was the units that they used to service the aircraft, you know, the light units, the generators and all that. You know, I went to that field where we could, work on those types of apparatus there, and then have them ready to, do the flight line check on planes and all that, you know. But I watch guys go into top fields. Yeah. Black guys right here out of Alabama.
Yeah.
But they scored high. It's going hot enough to do it. So it's a red herring.
I think it's
what that
as Christians, church is very critical in this part. Not just preaching the gospel, but being an example that if we're all unified in the spirit of Christ, where there's no bond, no free, no black, no white. I, as a black brother, bold enough to talk to a white brother and say, hey, you know, and I know you don't believe that.
Absolutely.
Because we have the mind of Christ.
Yeah.
Show the world that we as Christians, we don't believe that. Amen. Collectively.
Yeah. Right. Good.
As long as we're dealing with it on our side of the fence and they're on their side of the fence, just like they deal with it in the same little groups, we have to show the world that we do have the mind of Christ by boldly saying, hey, brother, that white supremacist thing is white privilege.
Yeah.
I don't accept that.
I don't accept that.
And I know you don't go by that.
That's right. That's right.
Well, you need to walk in that.
That's good. The sad part to that is the church as a whole.
Okay.
Especially just for the point of this conversation, I'm gonna say the white evangelical church.
Right.
They have a thing in a lot of instances where they feel they need to cater or be extra sympathetic to the black Christian.
Right.
You know, but in Christ, if you're in Christ, it's gone anyway. Why do we need to revisit that? Why do we need to revisit that? You know, you still stuck on Christianity as a white man religion, then you got some more work.
That's right. That's the opportunity. Like I said, that's why it's so big. At the border, not crossing.
Yeah.
Because an opportunity.
Here.
You know,
here.
To progress. To make a good living.
Amen.
You know, and I can think about one of Brian's cousins.
Yeah.
He went in the Air Force. He went in the Air Force. Okay. He
properly. He's studying hard, working.
Yeah, sure.
He's flying. He's flying the F-15.
I'm sure he is.
And on my side, my cousin's daughter.
Right.
She went to school, worked hard.
Sure.
She's a doctor.
Sure.
OBGYN.
Yeah.
Deliver babies.
Yeah.
So just like that little girl said, that guy on there.
Very good. That was good. It was encouraging. You can be whatever you want to be.
Yes,
no. They can't tell me because I raised a daughter. My baby was raised by one of the biggest fools ever cut down. And nonstop, straight through school, through college, through grad school, and now she's a doctor. Now she's a doctor, in spite of my shortcomings, and I can't accept that excuse that the opportunity is not there.
So you, what you said is that whereby you encourage her in some way. There are a lot of people out here telling them. The man holding you back.
You might well forget that. That's the big thing about this. That's what it is.
Yeah.
And it's an affront to the gospel. When you do your digging and scratching and get to the base of this thing, the whole agenda is to replace God with God.
That's the same thing for the Marxists.
Because
Philippians tells us we can do all things
through Christ.
That's our mantra. Nothing we cannot do.
Absolutely.
If we just put our trust in the
Lord
and apply ourselves and study hard, we can do anything.
CIT doesn't do that.
No.
CIT, the black person is oppressed.
He's holding you back.
The white man is the racist.
Okay.
The Asian person should live in fear and be persecuted.
The
Hispanic, he always trying to get over and sneak over and all that.
Okay.
These are the labels.
Divisions, labels.
CIT has put on.
Which are all lies.
Right.
Basically, lies is what they are.
Absolutely.
It's amazing how lies, how lies can just seem like it gets all. But truth has a heart.
Truth, a lonely
one. It's a pact right that comes with truth.
Yeah.
Even with the border crisis we're looking at now, with these people coming across the border, and I heard one guy who he been down there in that situation for years now, evaluating the situation. Majority of the people that come to the border seeking asylum now. Let's get it right. That's what it's for. They got cell phones. They pay thousands of dollars to get thus far.
To get over
thus far.
Yeah.
So it's not that you're in a situation that's dire or deadly. Now, some of them are.
Yeah.
But they don't usually let them in. Because those are the Christians fleeing persecution.
Yeah, so they won't let them in.
That's right. You see what I'm saying?
That's right.
We need to look at this thing for what it truly is instead of just taking a word for it, because they lying to us.
Finding articles here on this military guy, I found that retired colonel here, Austin Baker. Did I give y'all one of those?
Oh, thanks. I didn't say
that. Okay.
You did this to Austin Baker.
I didn't give y'all Austin Baker.
Indigenous.
What I get y'all. Okay.
And this is absolutely right, Pastor. This critical race theory encourages and tolerates
different
and
angry. I got all
bunch of
copies.
Let's go with it.
All right, Tony, jump on that one then. Let's look at what this retired colonel here.
Okay.
To say about
military. Okay. It's a viewpoint article by Austin Bay, and the article is entitled "Uncle Sam Needs You for a Counter Psychological Warfare Strategy." Wow, that's a mouthful. All right, and it reads: "Divide and conquer, or divide and rule." Was a maxim Chinese strategist Sun Tzu stressed in 500 BC. Sun wrote that the supreme military commander subjugate other people's army without engaging in battle. Capture other people's fortified cities without attack. Defeating an enemy without fight is the true pinnacle
of excellence.
In the 4th century, that's been said, that's the plan.
That's right.
In the 4th century BC, Macedonia's Philip II, Alexander the Great's father, demonstrated a genius for the type of duplicitous diplomacy that weakens and divides. The authoritarian of Philip seeded resentment and aggravated old feuds and rival Greek city-states. Democratic cities were especially susceptible to his mix of threat, lies, and blandishment. Autocratic Macedonia leveraged Athens' endless internal political quarrels to splinter resistance.
Now, let's keep that. Go ahead.
When feuds escalated to minor wars, the Macedonian army would intervene. With Philip posing as a peacemaker, if he occasionally fell short of Sun Tzu's bloodless pinnacle, his policy cocktails of charm, coercive treachery, lies, and military muscle made it difficult for rival Greeks to unite and oppose his expansionist goals. Athens and Thebes finally allied, but way too late. Ultimately, Philip gained hegemonic control of Greece.
Yes, he did.
Communist China's long game.
Long game.
Long game. That's a word there, y'all. Audience, listen. Long game resembles Philip II. Except China seeks global hegemony, substitute propaganda and psychological warfare for lies and coercive treachery. In China's shorter game, tactics and operations to achieve his goal also model Philip.
What I was just about now, offensive psychological.
Okay, offensive psychological warfare, disinformation operations, and agitation propaganda have become media terms for Philip's method.
Okay.
But divide and conquer without risking major war remains
the
goal.
They don't want none of it. Right. Because they don't want to end this whole thing.
No, you know,
but yet it's still the tactic we see in our community and in our nation today is being pushed and promoted.
Absolutely. And if we look on the world stage, we saw it was in the news all last week, the big meeting with Biden and Putin over there.
Yeah.
If you just look at how when they were sitting on the stage, just the posture of those two men sitting there tell you a whole lot about what Putin thought about this.
Yes,
he knows this man is weak. We have a weak leader right now.
Very weak.
But they know America, as it always has strength and power, and they don't want to do it on the war level.
No,
but they're going to fight it just like...
We don't want to commit suicide.
No.
You know, but this level of internal strife... Go ahead. Let's give you a little bit more.
China employs these and similar subversive methods. Combined with coercive threats, they become great area warfare.
Lots of threats today.
Yes. Right now, the United States and Communist China are engaged in a very dangerous great area warfare. And Beijing is the aggressor. Wow, that's big. Information age digital media deluge with emotionally and politically manipulative calls celebrates and the increasingly controlled by autocratic billionaire elites. Gates and all the
all these big people.
In authoritarian states. Right. Key battlefield in this war.
That's true. Key.
Don't know nothing. You get outside of basketball, LeBron
is
lost as a high ball. He has an audience. Use him to pander to his audience.
The same way.
They use him as useful idiots.
Political pundits is what it is.
That's right. Go ahead.
Unfortunately, vital American political institutions are also battlefields.
Yes, they are.
To include the National Security and Intelligence Services and the U.S. military. According to the Pentagon, psychological warfare as a doctrine is directed solely against enemy audience. I pointed out in a recent column that the Department of Defense, by including so-called critical race theory in training programs, receiving distrust and discord.
That's what they're doing.
That's right. That undermines unit cohesion,
what you need in the military,
and command authority. And quite simply, damn respect for fellow service members as individual human beings.
It does that. Stripped what? Stripped of what?
Stripped of academic poppycock.
Okay.
CRT defines Americans to racial caste. That is. That is. See, critical theory, you can plug anything in the middle of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Whether it be race or gender or whatever. But it's the critical theory that gets it.
And the reason I did not succeed because of you.
That's right. Right. That's right. Somebody else fault.
Yeah. You white.
Yeah. You got your foot on
you
right.
Had an opportunity more than I did. Because I ain't gonna mention all that rebound score.
Yeah, they ain't got nothing to do with it.
Okay.
CRT confines Americans to racial caste.
Okay.
Which means it's disgustingly racist.
Okay.
Since CRT insists on division, it is inherently divisive.
Yeah.
Philip II would see the possibility. No doubt, Xi Jinping is enthused.
Yes.
For the record, Philip had slaves and Brooke, no opposition.
Okay.
Xi has Uyghurs or whatever that is, and China is an enslaved nation for the state-controlled media.
Right.
Can't say nothing but what they tell them they can say.
That's right. Control, I mean complete.
That's
control.
Right. That's right.
And still, they stir in the pot.
That's right.
See, now you think about it now. The United States is slowly getting there because social media won't let you say it.
They're censoring. They're censoring right now. Yeah.
Won't you say it?
Yeah, they're censoring right now.
Facebook is tightening up completely.
Yeah, you knew it was coming. Cause look, this is, we just read an article controlled by the global elites, like Zuckerberg and all these.
Yeah.
That we might ask a character like Hunter Biden about Beijing's ability to pass cash to influence foreign leaders.
Yeah, he can tell us a lot.
What is to be done?
Okay, bluntly.
Bluntly, America needs a counter psychological warfare strategy that can confront China and Russia
and
destructive lies and treat anti-American propaganda like CRT as the faculty club rubbish it is. The goal is building public awareness of the societal resistance to these psychological warfare assault designed to shatter us. The Biden administration is enthralled to CRT advocates. So individual American and private sector organizations willing to defend freedom must be the initial act. Treat these columns as my personal contribution. That's a good one.
Yeah.
Because you were paid for this type of information.
Yeah. On one end, you say you're trying to, you know, in the inauguration speech of the president, he said he's going to bring people together.
That's what he said.
How do you bring people together by dividing people?
You can't.
And a place of all places, the military.
That's good. The military.
The pastor was in the
chair. The foxhole.
It's a little different.
But the Marine Corps.
In the Marine Corps, it is very important for us to have one camaraderie.
Sure.
I mean, you shower together. I mean,
you fight together. You're in the foxhole together.
Absolutely. Yes. Your life.
Yeah. Yes.
Your life is in this brother's hand.
To have
so here's politics down in the foxhole.
Yes.
I would tell that brother that the enemy is coming against him on the other side of it, but he's a Democrat.
Right. That's how it's gonna work. That's
how
it's gonna work. That's sad. You know, Black Lives Matter.
That's why when Biden was over there in the G7, the world got a chance to see something that very rarely seen with America. And that he went over there and just bashed the Republican Party.
Yes, sir.
He just bashed the Republican Party and talk about all the shortcomings and all the he trying to clean up the previous administration.
Yeah,
on the world stage.
World stage.
Mm-hmm. If they smell, they like sharks. You know, Putin, if he smell weakness, buddy, that's a shark.
That's
right. If he smell weakness, then
he's a shark, bro.
Let me read a little bit about the protesters in California to this CRT thing here. They are really an uproar there because of what the teacher is there. Los Alamitos, that's California, y'all. About 150 protesters together outside Los Alamitos Unified School District on May 11th. As the board unanimously voted to implement new social justice standards in the classroom.
our children. Our former said that they were concerned to lessen the teacher's critical race theory. And ideology that divides society into oppressors and the oppressed. Okay. Based on characteristics such as race, sex, class, or sexual proclivities. Y'all hear that? The district superintendent denied that the new standards would teach theology. The writer was held in front of the district office, even though the board met online due to health and safety concerns and recommendations of law enforcement. Crowds gathered from throughout Orange County region to protest the new guidance. They should be teaching facts, not ideology.
That's right.
That was really said in Long Beach here. The anchor domains in the social justice standards are values that their parents should be deciding upon, not students.
That's right. That's it.
It's common sense, ain't it?
Yeah.
The government school should be right down the middle. You know, in other words, so the government trying to take our kids from us.
That's it.
Yeah. Huh? Okay. Superintendent Fulber said during the May 11th board meeting that the standards don't teach each one of them pro CRT, but don't teach CRT, but are a guide for teachers to shape their lesson into a way that is a little bit more culturally.
What's the difference?
Relevant.
What's the difference?
Just a long way to say.
Critical race theory is not something that we're implementing, you said. Many of our students of color and of different ethnic backgrounds have really expressed that they want to see themselves more in that.
Okay. The children ain't said that.
You know, they want to see themselves more within that classroom and don't want to have to wait until when they get to high school and then let alone take an elective ethnic course, you know. They want, you know, black studies in the Okay, social justice standards are a set of guidelines divided into four domains: identity, diversity, justice, and action. The standards were provided by Learning for Justice, formerly known as Teaching Tolerance, founded by Southern Poverty. Y'all know what that is, don't
you? Yes.
Southern Poverty Law Center, that's here in Alabama.
Yeah.
They're formed in Alabama.
Yeah.
They were out there in California raising hell. okay, now I want to oppose the viewpoint. So, I got a friend of mine that had me a lot of material. Opposed a few points. More than 30 people took to the podium during the protest to share their concern about the curriculum. They focus on the narrative instead of focusing on the truth, and they really should be focused on academics,
said Simmons,
father of two children in the school district. Simmons cited a recent comment by superintendent in the article about that. He said that the board intends to highlight core ethnic studies concepts such as equality. That's what they want to bring in, equality, justice, and race. They want to inject that into the curriculum. Simmons said equality is a polar opposite of equity, is a polar opposite of equality.
That's right. That's it.
You can't have both. We believe in equal opportunity. Everybody has the same truth, but equity is forced outcome.
That's it.
That's critical race.
That's what it is.
He said many parents and students dare not speak against CRT because of the fear of being ostracized. I understand for the students because that's not a good situation. They could lower their grades.
You think they do that too?
Oh, absolutely. They could destroy their future.
Absolutely.
If they stand up and take a stand against
Come
the
on,
teacher.
Bro, that's right.
But our kids are in a bad situation.
They are. They really are. That's why you got to start at the house, training them before they leave the house.
So you intimidate now. They're going to school being intimidated.
Yes.
And so careful. They be careful even what they say.
Yes.
What kind of atmosphere you creating there? You can't express yourself.
Right.
Same way with your college students. They go off to
college. Absolutely.
They're afraid to speak up.
Because the professors will go to college. They feel they might get a low grade. You know? And that's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, we have to stop there, brother. But you got some good. Despite the color of your skin, we are all the same. What they're trying to teach is the fact that maybe blacks or browns are better than white people. We're all the same.
Come on now. That's good. That's good. And I say that boldly today. A Christian is a Christian is a Christian is a Christian. What is show me in the Word of God that the fact that I got more melanin in my skin makes me more of a Christian than anybody else? Ain't no such thing as more of a Christian.
Doesn't. They can't say it.
It's amazing, but that's what CRT teaches.
Right, right. So it's division. Basically, it's division. If divided, we go fall. Together we stand, divided we'll fall. And we're going in the wrong direction now, basically what we're saying. Okay, Kevin, let's sum it up here, baby. Get two.
Yeah, that little girl that was on that video.
Yeah,
kids,
that
all kids wanted to do was play.
Very smart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And whoever had the ball, they played with.
Want to grow them up?
Yeah.
You want to?
We need to have that same attitude as adults.
Yes,
we don't need to let these labels that the media the CRT is imposing upon us to live by. We don't need that. All I want to do is just tell the gospel.
Yes.
Preach the gospel.
That's right.
And whoever wants to believe it with me and whoever the power comes upon to share that with me, that's who I'm with.
And they said I knew that Bill Gates spent most of his time in his Montana conclave over there. They don't white, they don't black on what we see.
That's right.
Way out there, you know, and, but then come back in the city right here. Go ahead. I'm
gonna do you one better. Patrice Cullors the same way.
Yep.
Patrice Cullors the same way.
That's the black sister.
She got that right. Money and moved up in the hill. With the folks she can't, she hate that inherently racist.
Right.
All that. So, but people. And I want to speak specifically to the church right here.
Mm-hmm.
We say, well, what them folk are down there making such a big deal out of it?
Okay.
But why are they just in the ditch? What is the big deal about it? They can preach the gospel and just let it be that.
Mm-hmm.
But that same mindset, that same attitude is why your children in elementary school today reading books like Johnny Got Two Moms.
Okay. Right. Okay.
Johnny got two dads.
Okay.
You know, sitting around not being aware of what's being pushed, what your children are being brainwashed with.
That's
but right. This CRT is a part of the Marxist agenda.
Yes, sir.
It's a big plan that's unfolding right before our eyes.
Right.
And if you don't stand up against this, go to the school, board, and voice your opinion about this CRT thing, then your children's future, the future of their children, all that is down the
gone. Amen. Bill, what do you say? Critical race theory.
It's reverse discrimination.
Okay.
Yeah.
Reverse discrimination.
That's what it is.
That's good.
Good.
I mean, people need to wake up. They need to get a hold of this thing and parents, grandparents.
Yes.
Talk to your children.
Good.
What they teaching them in school. Find out. You'll find out quick what they teach them in school, because kids are innocent like they look good.
That's right.
I'll never talk before.
Sure.
Kids are innocent.
That's right.
You know, I can be riding down the road and a little white kids in the car and they wave.
Sure.
I mean, because they're innocent.
Yeah. Don't think about that.
That's right.
But as believers, though, we need to stand firm and not be cowards.
Hey, that's right.
Amen. Not be cowards. Pray God, Jesus Christ, he did not keep silent in the face of so much lies, you know.
Amen.
And we can't do, we must stand firm. Right. Amen.
Thank
Father, in Jesus' name, thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. We pray your word, Lord, might touch the hearts of your people. We pray that someone might be in the light, Lord, realize that we've come too far to go back. Help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.